I would like to thank you. That's a great opportunity to meet you and to mention something which was triggered by Julia this morning, talking about, and Angela, about what is the role of Fulbright program. It's not only intercultural exchange. It is a melting pot of people who tried for centuries to go in different directions, developing different professions, trying to avoid discussion between each other, because we in physics, we'd like to keep our knowledge for ourselves. You in languages would like to keep your own. And now we are facing, it's not now, it's the last 50, 60 years already, that we need to go back and to start to talk to each other, to find the way to understand what we are talking about, and that most of the terms we have invented in a specific profession, they were invented because of two reasons. One is just because it's much easier to talk in short, because any term gives you a knowledge which usually takes two pages to explain, like this talk we just listened about genomics and how to edit the genome. And then another reason is that in mid-centuries, the people did not want to talk to each other. So thank you, Fulbright, for having us together. And I would like just to point you, you have the program with you, that this part is body, that's this session. And the talk I'm going to deliver very shortly, because it's much opening questions than giving answers to you, is actually ethical, and ethics is not related to the body. But I feel very much privileged, because now we are discussing the body and the human well-being as a source of thinking of our ethical behavior. And I would like again to thank for this arrangement of the program, because this saves a lot of my time. And we got a professional explanation about so-called emerging subjects. That's a general term, emerging subjects, which is explaining how the technologies, which are really very well developed in the modern world, could influence the total understanding of human technology interaction. And just one of the emerging subjects is something which is called with three different names, but it means the same. The names are bionanotechnology, nanobiotechnology, and nanobiology. So what is the essence of that is that all these terms refer to the intersection of nanotechnology and biology. Julia, surprisingly to me, mentioned this morning nano size. Actually, nano is not so new. You see, nanoscale, yeah, that's, as we say, 10 to the minus 9. It's 1/18,000 of a hair. Just you take a little hair and cut it 80,000 times, and you'll get the nanoscale. So usually what we are talking about nanoscience, that's technology and science at this nanoscale. The surprise is coming that you start with thinking that there is nothing wrong to work at this scale. But then you realize that you go so deep into the body, then you touch the development of this body, including the brain. And then we hit biology, which is the science of life. So now what is going these days? It was an excellent talk to open the informational channel about what's going on now. The people are very curious. No one will be stopped, even what we are discussing today. We are curious. We would like to go down, 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 and then we have all the technology to influence in this nanoscale, because nanoscale is much smaller than the size of a cell. The cell of any skin or what kind of cell, these are huge objects. It's something like to compare an ant to an elephant, just to imagine what. So then you say, okay, I will touch this little thing at the nanoscale, and this huge cell will not even think, feel, or whatsoever. But that's not correct. So I will try just to tell you what's going on now. The next slide says, what's that intersection? That's my point, is that the intersection, which is a very simple word which we use every day, even for crossroads or different things, now with this level of size, the intersection could be completely different story. It could be the normal static, like crossroad, crossing something. But what we mean that is intersection is dynamic, which means that it's interaction. And what's wrong with interaction here? It's not wrong, but surprisingly, we change the media. So you start to work with two bodies, and because of this interaction, one of the body changed completely. So when you said that the process is long and you mentioned 6 months, I said, well, okay, the nature had billions of years to do so. So it's too rapid what you do. And in fact, in my point is that we try to compare our short human life of 100 years or with billions of years. And the nature, I don't know what nature is, but that's the general term, the nature had all this time to manipulate everything. So what we see here is, that's the point, interacting media. And then going to interacting media to change it. And now the ethical issues. It was mentioned in the during the presentation. We heard that the ethical issues are really not just items. It's not an issue 1, 2, 3. It's a combination of all together. Because if it is 1, 2, 3, you can just put several of them aside, solving 1, 2, and then you go to 3, 4, 5. That's not the point. The ethical issues come to you in combinations, and those combinations are completely different. In physics, we are saying that that's the probability to have 3, 4 different things like health, safety, and medical combined with a different weight. So which is more important? And all the time you should decide. Is it more important to improve the health of this human? And then you face the problem that the safety of the other humans is not guaranteed. So all these things are very difficult in two brief talks to explain, because you could easily say, stop, do it. But, well, there are important things which we have already understood at this level. And it will be just impossible to stop her or me to try to improve something which is obviously wrong, because all these trials of the natures produce some wrong sequences. But who cares in the nature? I mean, the nature will improve it in the next 3 generations. And then you cannot stop humans who know how to do it and say, well, okay, I know that's a wrong twist into the DNA, and I can do it in 6 months, 6 years, and you'll be much better. So you see the point. But then you go to this legal aspect. And the legal aspect, which is the first line, the legal aspect, to me at least, is the most difficult one. Because laws in nature are the same in United States, in France, in Korea, Bulgaria, anywhere. So that's the nature. But the laws in a country, they are completely different. And now we have this trans-border exchange of knowledge, of skills, and information. And, you know, I'm not going to touch, because it's really a very difficult point starting the last few days, about this legal aspects of bordering, of transferring through borders different information. So, and then we go to these other ethical issues, which include the governance of research. Let me just immediately say that this is very important, not to let a complete governance of research. I mean, there should be some governance, but to stop research, that's nothing which we as Fulbrighters could support, although there are a lot of voices about that. And then there are economic displacement, anthropological aspects, and transhumanism. So you heard something about transhumanism already, because when we talk about improving the health, changing this and that, we still stay in the field of body, as this part is. But then when you go directly to this underlined sentence that we would like to enhance human intellect and physiology together, using all these modern techniques for improving the human health, it's becoming a bit, I would say, fragile thing. But at the moment, you see, I've basically converted the last 1.5 years. I started to do a lot of this artificial intelligence on the machines, trying to use all these new algorithms, the concept of deep learning. And in fact, the people who are still in this artificial intelligence field, they talk about neural networks as a source of information. But now you see, I put this backslash from neural networks to intellect. And now we are going to think about the future robots, but the future robots are already here. If you do not know, they are walking, they are helping, they are answering your questions, and when you come to Sofia Tech Park, you can see several of them. They are still very, I would say, not successful in communication, but what we believe that with this deep learning, and you will see the point, they will learn how to behave, and there is no need to have them anymore like robots. I mean, like beautiful little toy for play. We can do it completely differently, but it will be the next talk when I am going to show what is more interesting. And then synthetic biology. This is something which I spent 5 years on, because synthetic biology is very not ethical. I told you that biology is science of life. And then you go to synthetic biology. What is that? What we are playing? But on the other side, just mechanically, synthetic biology could be very useful, until you go again to this black arrow, which goes back to physiology. Because we are pretty sure that physiology influences our behavior as well. And then I mentioned the neural networks. That's something which probably is interesting for everyone, because the important property of neural network is that you are getting every day better results when you put more data, when you have a bigger scaled models and you put a lot of computations, then you use better algorithms, new insight, improved techniques, and finally you have something which, when you just stop watching and just thinking, neural network is something which is self-evolving system. And this is new to us, because we push the system under our rules, but the self-evolution is something which we cannot control after some point. So that's the ethical aspect I wanted. I don't want to make the Friday 13 a difficult day for you, but that's the end of the week. So you have 2 days for the weekend to swallow all this information and to have this nice weather as a very helpful environment. So that's the person who started the story about trans. So that's transhumanist test of fate. So Steve Fuller, I sent this information to the commission if they would like to distribute it, because this person is very productive. There is already a big, large society, which actually, I saw that your talk was about Humanity 2.0, and these people, they have a foundation for transhumanism. They publish books, but not only this, they are very active all over Europe, United States, and Latin America already, because they are on this side of understanding that everything which could be done to make the humans better should be done. That's in short. And now I would like just to go like in the old movie about the good and the bad and the ugly, with the three aspects which we can think of, all these nanobio things which are coming. So let's start with the good, of course. Nanomedicine, it's here. This is already something which we use for diagnostics. So all these nanomaterials can be used as sensors or monitors. So there are several examples, but that's not needed at the moment, really, to read all these kind of words. But the good thing is that we know how to clean the surface of drinking water in the rivers using nanoparticles. So, because you know that nanosilver is antibacterial substance, we just put it over there, it is cleaned, but then we are asked ourselves what's happening with these nanoparticles. And we know the answers, that they sometimes are not very good, but anyway, they are under control. So nanomedicine is here, and just briefly, this country will specifically fund nanomedicine starting in mid-July. There is a national scientific program of that. The bed. So I mentioned about nanoparticles, which we throw on the surface of the river to clean the bacteria, but then again, the same thing could be bad, because nanotoxicology is the toxic effect of nanoparticles on specific flora or fauna of the river. So you clean it, you make it usable for us humans, but then you discover that some of the plants just disappear. So that could be. And then it becomes too ugly. I'm sorry to mention, because that's actually my example for cell engineering, but I put ugly with if no ethics. So it could be tailored in a way to be not ugly when all this genetic engineering, bioengineering, and cell engineering follow specific ethical aspects, which are quite possible to be followed. So, in fact, the people made a study, which is social survey, in 2015 about the ethical issues associated with nanotechnology research. You can see that 40% of the people are afraid that the medicine is generating the most important ethical challenge in nanobiotechnology. 30% think that the environment could be influenced badly with this research, and only 10% consider the social issues. But I don't know what will happen in the next 10 years when the field will be already mature with a lot of results ahead of us. So my talk ends with the normal thanking for listening, but I don't know if it is seen. It's written, the future of the Earth depends on our present ethical behavior. So that's the end of this talk.